Good morning, colleagues. It's always a pleasure to be with you every Thursday at 11 a.m. in the morning to give you an update on the COVID situation on the continent. So let me switch over to the epidemiological situation. As of 9 a.m. East African time today, 16 of April, there were a total of above 2 million cases of COVID-19 reported across the world. And of that number, 120,000 about have unfortunately died. And again, as I said last week, this is an extremely dangerous virus, replicates very quick, and is a very vicious virus in terms of transmission. You may ask, what is the situation on our continent? As of today, this morning, about 17,200 individuals have been infected on the continent, and these cases are reported from 52 member states. Last week when we met, the cases were 46% lower than it is today. So you can see that we have almost increased by 50% the number of cases from last week to this week. The number of deaths as of today stands at 910, with 3,546 recovery, which is a good thing for us to celebrate. The question is always asked, which are the countries that have the, are reporting the highest number of cases now? We have in the first five countries include South Africa with about 2,500 cases, Egypt 2,500 cases, Algeria 2,100 cases, Morocco 2,000 cases, and Cameroon about 850 cases. Let me now just shift your attention to and take you a little bit down into the number of how we are seeing the deaths here. If you compare the what we call the fatality rate, which is of those who are infected, those who die, what proportion does that represent? It is at about 6%. And I think we are seeing in some countries that this rate is higher than the global, what we see globally there. Let me now shift your attention to our response. What have we done since the last time we spoke with you? In partnership with the World Health Organization and the World Food Program and the Ethiopian Airlines, we are in the process of supporting the distribution of the second shipment of medical supplies that came from the donation between the Jack Ma Foundation and the Prime Minister of Ethiopia, Prime Minister Abiy Ahmed, and that distribution has already started. And in terms of the content, we receive about 950,000 virus transport media. These are things that solutions that they use in collecting the specimens from the patient or the individual for testing. We receive a similar amount of reagents that are needed to extract the genetic material of the virus from the specimen. We also receive about 190,000 medical disposable protective clothes, that is gowns. We receive 190,000 face shields and 456 ventilation machines. We also receive about 1,800 temperature scanners, 475,000 medical gloves, and those are being distributed aggressively as we speak. This is very important for the protection of our public, of our healthcare workers, as well as individuals on the front line. We continue to work with screening to increase member states' ability to support member states in their diagnostic capacity. At this point, I would like to make an important announcement that going forward, starting next week, we are going to launch an initiative called Partnership to Accelerate COVID Testing, which will be have a tagline of tests and trace. Again, I'll repeat slowly, Partnership to Accelerate COVID-19 Testing. in abbreviation PACT, P-A-C-T, with a running title of testing and tracing. This is important because, as I explained last week, there is a big gap on the continent on testing, so we will be rolling out, as Africa CDC and African Union Commission, more than 1 million tests in the coming 1 week to 1.5 week to support countries so that they can increase the ability to test and also increase the ability to trace individuals. We shall also be accompanying this initiative by a community healthcare workers program that will support countries, especially those at the top, with that I mentioned, the 5 or 6 countries that have the highest rates, and other countries that are struggling with what we call a community healthcare workers program, where we believe that using the community will increase our ability for contact tracing. And I'm also very pleased to announce that the first partner in this initiative, in the PAC initiative, is UNAIDS, the United Nations AIDS Joint AIDS Program. And the executive director, Winnie, and I spoke at length yesterday, and she is extremely supportive, and UNAIDS will join forces with us to expand community reach and contact tracing on this program. I think that is very, very important. The fundamentals of this is that there are 4 things we need to do if we have to have a fighting chance in the coming 4 weeks to beat back the virus on the continent. One is scale up testing and isolate the infected individuals, trace them, and make sure that we find out how the virus is spreading in the community, especially now that we have lockdowns going on in the countries. Second is we have to protect our healthcare workers as much as possible. It will be a disaster if our healthcare workers are not protected deliberately upfront. It means there will be a lot of nosocomial infection, and it will be difficult for them to support other treatments across the continent. We know the shortage, the acute shortage of healthcare workers that we have on the continent. We cannot afford to lose them to COVID-19. Thirdly, we'll be focusing on communities. We'd like to make sure that the communities' response is strong. We shall only be effective with contact tracing if we have a strong community response component. That is where the UNAIDS comes in. And fourthly, is commodities. We need a constant supply chain management to feed the entire response spectrum there. I think those are the 4 pillars that we will be looking at going forward and working with you all. The Africa CDC is also working on what we call the genomic sequencing network as part of the task force. What does this mean? It means that we'll be building on reference labs around the continent where we can analyze the full genome of the virus and understand the patterns, how the virus is circulating in our member states and on the continent, so that we can trace it to the source of the outbreak and use that to sharpen our response strategies there. Let me just switch on to other things that we are doing. 466 clinicians have attended our last webinar training on clinical community of practice. That is, this is a community that will help manage the patients there. 56 surveillance experts from 23 member states have attended the last 2 trainings for community surveillance. Again, they will help with our efforts of the testing and tracking there. People have always asked what is the situation of treatment. Now, as we speak, there are 4 clinical trials for COVID-19 treatment registered on the continent, and they include a chloroquine clinical trial in South Africa, a solidarity trial for remdesivir, chloroquine, hydrochloroquine, lopinavir, and interferon beta in South Africa. So the first 2 are all in South Africa. In Nigeria, we have an aspirin, losartan trial going on in Nigeria, and lastly in Egypt, natural honey treatment. These are registered trials, which means that we are tracking those. We have a record of what they're doing. They have a scientific protocol that has been read carefully and reviewed and approved by an ethical committee there. So in terms of clinical strategy, Africa CDC is mapping out the medical equipment capacity on the continent. Our records show that South Africa has the highest number of ventilators, about 1,500. 10 countries have no ventilators. However, we have arranged to ship some of the ventilators donated by the Jack Ma Foundation to them and to link them with neighboring countries that also have ventilators. Egypt has the highest number of clinical care beds with about 10,300, and six member states do not have that. We say this because as we continue to receive supplies, these are some of the gaps excuse me, that will be filled as the pandemic evolves. Some South African companies have started producing low-cost ventilator units. That is a very good sign to see local production and manufacturing begin to happen on the continent. So I would like to end by emphasizing that the restriction in movement imposed by countries may be having inconveniences, mainly in the socioeconomic effects, but the long-term gain are incomparable. There is always a pain before gain, and that is a price that we have to pay to contain this virus, which we must, as I've said earlier, win the battle against this virus in order to survive. I encourage everyone to continue to stay safe and to continue to spread the message, the right message in the communities, especially join us to fight false information, fake news, and misinformation. Thank you.